Good evening. There's something about communal singing that, especially when it's directed to our Lord, is so nourishing. I really enjoyed that. So first I want to say, as it says in the program here, that I've never been a Seventh-day Adventist myself. So what I'm going to give is really just a thin slice of how some of my thinking and my understanding has developed as an evangelical Christian, as a follower of Christ. And hopefully, for each of us, as we grow and we dig into the scriptures, we'll find ourselves changing our minds about some things over time. And specifically, since this is germane to the topic of the conference this year, I want to tell something about how my view of the Ten Commandments has changed. Because frankly, I think that the Christian church has had a hard time knowing exactly how to think about the relationship of the Old Covenant and the New, and the Ten Commandments specifically. And so have I. At first when I was younger, I thought we were under the Ten Commandments, and that keeping the Sabbath just meant going to church. And then I didn't believe we were under the Ten Commandments. And then I did again, except for the Sabbath. And now I believe that we are not under the Ten Commandments, but under the law of Christ. See, as a young believer, and for many years, I assumed, and it was mostly an assumption, that God wanted us to obey the Ten Commandments. And I believe this because they were the Ten Commandments, right? Not the Ten Suggestions. And that seemed to settle it, right? And after all, the Ten Commandments are one of the first lessons you learn in Sunday school. And that gives the impression that they must be very important. And they were only spoken of in church and as though they were God's will for our lives. So, about the time I was ending college, and I was raised in a Christian environment. I was a church kid and grew up in the church. Around the time I was ending college, I began to see that the way I had been taught to kind of put all the parts of the Bible together really failed to account for the New Testament's theology of fulfillment, of the types and shadows and the promises and prophecies in the Old Covenant, and failed to account for the whole trajectory of redemptive history that culminates in Christ. So my thinking was beginning to shift on some things. And around the same time, probably beginning around 2005, and for about the decade following that, I was learning a lot about the theological tradition that developed out of the Protestant Reformation and came to be called covenant theology. And that way of understanding how the Bible fits together is probably best characterized by its focus on the theme of the divine covenants as framing the whole biblical narrative, with Jesus Christ as a central character, even in the Old Testament. And these are things that I still think are right, but there were some other aspects of that theological system that eventually posed some problems for me. See, one of the central points in covenant theology is the abiding authority of the moral law of the Old Covenant, meaning the Ten Commandments. So they kind of hold on to that aspect of the Old Covenant and bring it over into the New Covenant. See, in covenant theology, the Mosaic Law is divided into three parts, civil, ceremonial, and moral law. And while those who hold to that position properly understand that the civil and ceremonial aspects have been done away with, they say that the moral aspects of the Mosaic Law continue into the New Covenant era. And they believe that the moral law is summed up in the Ten Commandments. In fact, whenever I say moral law in covenant theology, you can just understand Ten Commandments, and that we must obey those today. And this includes, of course, the fourth commandment to observe the Sabbath as a weekly day of rest. Now, interestingly, I was never convinced that the weekly Sabbath was a requirement for New Covenant Christians. So it seemed at odds to me with the New Testament, Colossians, Romans, Galatians, especially Hebrews chapters 3 and 4, where, and this is a phrase I mentioned earlier, once again, a theology of fulfillment, seemed to explain the true meaning and the lasting significance of the Sabbath, which was the sign of the Old Covenant. Sabbatarianism seemed to cling to the shadow. Which Paul, in Galatians, and especially Colossians chapter 2, warns us not to do. So I didn't hold to Sabbath keeping, but I was convinced of all the rest of it. So this put me in the position of holding to covenant theology while simultaneously taking exception to perhaps one of its most important and logical implications, and that's the continued practice of the weekly Sabbath. So, I held to the authority of the Ten Commandments, except for the Sabbath, which is one of the Ten Commandments. And I remained in this odd state of belief for years. Now, I want to point out that Reformed theology is in many places, and in the most important places, very different from what any of you may have learned as an Adventist. It's generally good theology, but in its teaching of the law and the Ten Commandments, it's quite similar. It's quite similar. In fact, being familiar with Reformed lingo and Reformed arguments, I was quite shocked at how similar it was to the arguments made by Adventists for the continuing authority of the moral aspects of the Mosaic Law. For instance, covenant theology teaches the following things. It teaches that the moral law of God is summarized in the Ten Commandments. It teaches that the Ten Commandments are a transcript of God's character. You'll find that phrase in among Reformed authors. Okay, meaning that they're based on God's character and therefore they are unchanging and everlasting. They teach that the Ten Commandments were written on the heart of Adam and Eve at creation. And that Sabbath keeping was instituted at the beginning of creation. It's a creation ordinance. And it's a moral law of God. And just like the other nine commandments, it was required to be kept, not only by the Jews in Old Testament times, but by everybody, all the time. It's always a requirement. And it also teaches that the law given to the Israelites under the Old Covenant can be divided, as I said, into moral, civil, and ceremonial categories, and that the moral law contained in the Ten Commandments are forever unchanging and always binding. So that whenever the law appears to be affirmed or upheld in the New Testament, they say, well, this is a reference to the moral law only, and not to all the other laws, since we know that they've been abrogated. So, do these teachings sound familiar? They may. These teachings really emerge from a belief system that diminishes the distinctiveness and the newness of the new covenant, and which seeks to make the spiritual lives of the people of God in the old covenant really as similar as possible to our own in the new covenant. Now, obviously, the fact that I saw that the New Testament does away with the weekly Sabbath. I could see that. Sometimes in pretty strong terms. Galatians 4, Paul says, I'm afraid for you because you're still keeping special days. Colossians 2, you know, he says, don't let anyone judge you in regards to new moons or feasts or Sabbath days. These things, he says, are a shadow, but the substance, the body, the reality is Christ. And I saw that, and that didn't square with the notion that the Ten Commandments are still binding. since the Sabbath commandment is one of the 10. Now, it was in 2014. In 2014, Gary gave a Bible study series through the book of Galatians, actually, and that's attending that's when I really began to doubt whether the Ten Commandments themselves were still in effect. Now, I'm not talking about some of the principles embodied in the Ten Commandments, but the Ten Commandments per se, the Ten Commandments as the Decalogue. Are those still in effect? I thought they were, but man, he went through Galatians and sure sound like maybe they weren't. And I didn't really know where to go with that. It's just kind of something that I was thinking about for a while, but I really don't like these inconsistencies. And eventually things came to a head. And I felt like I had to ask myself what kind of doctrine of the Ten Commandments I could hold to if it was clear to me that the weekly Sabbath was no longer a requirement, and that in fact Jesus himself was the fulfillment of the Sabbath law. Two things couldn't both be true. Unfortunately, I discovered I was not the only one that came to this conclusion. By God's providence, I was able to find a host of teaching resources by men whose understanding of the relationship of the Old and the New Testament is driven by the following principles. And this really helped clarify for me how the covenants relate to each other and what that means, what the implications are. Some of the principles are the following. One is the interpretive priority of the New Testament. It's simply the application of a couple of truths. First, that God's revelation to mankind has been given to us progressively over time, a long period of time, with new revelation shedding light on previous revelation. And this progressive revelation culminates in the person of Jesus Christ. Hebrews 1:1 says that in the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways, but in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son. It also means that Old Testament promises and prophecies and law are interpreted in the light of the New Testament revelation, and not the other way around. Not even necessarily the way they would have been understood by the original hearers, who did not have the mystery revealed in the light of Christ's coming. The new interprets the old. Another principle is that the culmination, the end and purpose of all that God is doing in history finds its apex in Jesus Christ. He's the reality to which all previous signs and symbols in the Old Testament pointed. He is the seed of Abraham. He's the true Israel. He's the one like Moses. He's, in fact, the temple. He's the lamb. He's the altar. He's the showbread. He's the manna from heaven. He's the rock that provided water in the wilderness. He's the Davidic king and the Davidic heir. He's the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. He said that himself in Matthew chapter 5. Not just the fulfillment of the prophets, the fulfillment of the law, too. The law served a prophetic purpose, a sign purpose in itself. That's very interesting. All the promises of God find their yes in Christ. Also, that the old covenant was meant by God to be temporary. And the Ten Commandments, and this was key to me, the Ten Commandments were specifically the terms of the old covenant. So they're now obsolete. The Ten Commandments don't outlast the Old Covenant because the Ten Commandments, to put it in shorthand, the Ten Commandments were the Old Covenant. They're repeatedly called in Deuteronomy the tables of the covenant. And they were placed in the Ark of the Covenant, the Old Covenant. They were the written terms of the Old Covenant. So when we read in the New Testament, and in Hebrews in particular, that the Old Covenant has passed away, that necessarily means that the Ten Commandments have passed away as well. They're no longer binding. But that doesn't mean we're without law I mean, you know, it doesn't mean we can do whatever we want. Whenever you talk about, well, I don't believe that we're under the Ten Commandments, so you believe that we can worship idols and commit adultery and, well, no. But it's not because of the Ten Commandments themselves. And this was a big switch that went on in my brain about what the Bible actually says. The code of conduct for the Christian believer is the law of Christ. We're still under authority. The authority of our Lord, the new lawgiver, Jesus himself. And the law of Christ is summed up in Jesus' new commandment to love as he loved. He told his disciples, "A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another." There was an aspect of love that was required in the old covenant. But the newness of it is that Jesus says, "As I have loved you, so you must love one another." That's new. That didn't come until Jesus came. The central pillars in the walk of the Christian are love and the imitation of Christ, and that can be shown from many New Testament texts. That is what defines how a follower of Christ is to conduct himself. Now, more details about what this looks like, what this love looks like, are found in the imperative passages dotting the New Testament all over the place. Be kind to one another, forgiving one another in Christ, just as God in Christ forgave you. There's that aspect of imitation of Christ, which is definitional of how we conduct ourselves. So at the core of our way of life, actually, is not a set of rules. There are rules. That's not at the core of our new life in Christ, a spirit-filled life. At the core of it is a ruler, a person, amen, the Lord Jesus himself. And that's what I came to see. That's what I came to discover. I'm much indebted to all the theological reading that I did, you know, for many, many years. If you ever have a chance to read Michael Horton or Kevin DeYoung or R.C. Sproul, please do. It will only be a blessing. Nonetheless, they do carry with them some of the weight of a theological system that I believe has read the New Testament improperly. And that's what I wanted to share with you tonight.
Thank you, Jordan. Jordan is a member of Redeemer Fellowship here, and interestingly, he is a proofreader for Proclamation Magazine. So thank you, Jordan. Coming up, we're going to hear from Paul Carden. He's executive director of the Centers for Apologetic Research. He's had over 30 years of cult-related research and outreach in Latin America. 15 years working with Walter Martin. Ever heard of him? Yeah, he's special for us, isn't he? He wrote the book, The Kingdom of the Cults, where we believe he missed Adventism a little bit, quite a bit. And also, I've had the privilege of serving with him for the last, I think, 6 years or almost, something like that, on his board. He invited me to join him on his board a few years back, and it's been just a pleasure working with him, getting to know him better. I consider him my brother and fellow worker in the quest to distribute and preach the truth of the Bible. And then after him, our keynote speaker is Kaspars Ozolins. He is the research associate in Old Testament and the Ancient Near East at Tyndale House in Cambridge. It's a mouthful for me. But he already spoke this morning. We really enjoyed his teaching. He will again speak tomorrow evening. So he's also been our worship leader. So welcome these two men up here first, Paul and then Kaspars.
Oh. But I have 20 minutes of statistics for you. Fasten your seatbelts. Plus, I have to learn how to run this tablet thing here. So there's no telling what might happen. Look at this. So far, so good. Question. I'm rephrasing the name of this presentation as
a question. Should Seventh-day Adventist growth alarm evangelical Christians?
Yes.
Oh, my work is done. Well, maybe not. Let's take a closer look. Considerations. Let's take a look at the most recent world membership statistics. That is, as of December 31st, 2018. Notice total church membership. Can you see this? Oh, not too bad. 21.4 million. Total accessions, which means folks joining up in 2018. 1.38 million. Let's go further. In their mission to the world. Countries and areas where the Seventh-day Adventist Church's work is established. Now, the United Nations says that there are 235 countries and areas in the world. Out of that total, the Adventist Church is busy in 213. Pretty bad. Should we be alarmed? Languages used in publications and oral work, 557. Compare that with 188 for the Mormons. Just to give you a little context. Where are the Adventists? Well, as I said, nearly everywhere. And this is a map of their 15 General Conference World Divisions. Now, they use a lot of peculiar geographical designations in Adventism. They have missions, union conferences, mission fields, attached territories. It gets very confusing for someone like me who just wants some basic numbers on who's where and what they're doing. But we will be focusing on just six regions of the world, as you'll find out in a moment. Looking at SDA membership growth over half a century, we've got a pretty big swooping upward line there. Not so encouraging for people like you and me. Here's something else, courtesy of David Trim of church headquarters. In the 54 years since 1964, over 37 million people have been, now that's an interesting way of putting it, have been Seventh-day Adventist church members. But that's still too many. Many too many. And they claim that based on these statistics, if you average things out, every 23 seconds, somebody becomes a Seventh-day Adventist. Should we be alarmed? You decide. Now, I need to thank my colleague at the Centers for Apologetics Research, Tim Martin, in Pennsylvania, for his massive help in gathering these numbers and sorting them out. There would not be a presentation tonight without him. Let's look at Seventh-day Adventist world membership by region. I told you that I would be talking about six regions. We're talking about Africa, North America, South America, Asia, Oceania, and Europe. Now, as of 2007, Africa dominates, clearly, followed by North and South America. Okay, bear that in mind. Now, let's compare with a decade later. Kaboom. There is an African explosion. An explosion. And stagnation. Look at this. In South America, Oceania, and Europe. Is this what you expected? Maybe not. But as far as looking at these matters strategically, these numbers are extremely important. And here again, by the numbers, Africa climbed from 5.3 million to 8.4 million, and so on. I don't think you need that much detail right now. Let's compare using the pie chart, though, because some people like pies better than bars. 2007, you see that big blue section of pie, Africa. Next biggest is North America, followed by Asia. And you can see that by 2017, which, by the way, is the last year for which we have country-by-country specific statistics. That's why you're seeing these two numbers. Africa continues to grow. And in fact, if you look at it on a percentage basis, Africa has grown by 58%. Not exactly, but almost twice as much. Oh, look at this. It dropped the name. It must be that Mac software. Dropped two of those names. Sorry about that. But you can see, again, that Africa's growth is very concerning indeed. What are the top 20 countries for Africa? Oh, my. Look at this. Okay, we have had a real data loss here, because in the slide that I originally came up with, there are 20 countries named individually. But let me tell you this about that. Zambia is number one. Zambia, that giant landlocked country in southern Africa. And it's followed closely by countries like Uganda and Rwanda, which, by the way, more than doubled in 10 years. They're just screaming hot. And we have to ask, why? The top 20 countries in Europe. Well, this is going to go much faster because the names are missing. Romania and Ukraine are numbers one and two. Very interesting, I think. And then you have the Western European and Nordic countries mostly fighting over what remains. It's even hard to tell where I am with these funny slides. Okay, Europe top 20 countries. Almost all of them are going down in Europe. Almost all of them, except for France and Spain. They're doing terribly in Europe. Let's see what happens here. Latin America, top 20 countries. Indulge me. Oh, look at this. Okay. Adventism is dominated in Latin America by three giant countries, Brazil, Mexico, and Peru. But there's a surprise with Peru. So hang on. Don't know if we have any Peruvians here tonight. Comparing now by growth. Look at Brazil grow. Mexico is also growing, even though it's one of the biggest Adventist countries in the world. But Peru, and you cannot see this because it's not named, Peru has shrunken by half. In other words, it's roughly 50% of what it used to be. And if you read the Adventist mission literature, and statistical literature, you can see that they're trying to adjust from some bad reporting practices. I'm suspecting that this is what happened in Peru, but because I can't imagine fully half of them just marching away. So that is a mystery yet to be solved. Sub-Saharan top 20 countries. Now, you know that Africa is basically Sahara with, you know, countries like Algeria and Egypt and Tunisia at the top. And then below the Sahara, you have just about everybody else. And in sub-Saharan Africa, Adventism is dominated by mostly English-speaking countries in East and Southern Africa. French-speaking countries, by and large, lose out. West African countries lose out. Now, let's look at these numbers again. Again, you can see that Zambia just exploded, as did Uganda and Rwanda. Did I mention that out of the top 20 countries, Adventist countries in the world, 11 are in Africa. They are, let me see, sub-Saharan Africa ranked by percentage growth. Now, Sudan is number one, but that's because Sudan didn't have a whole lot of members, and so if they grow a lot, it kind of places them awkwardly next to big countries like Zambia. Otherwise, Zambia, Uganda, and Rwanda more than doubled. Most of these are predominantly English-speaking nations, only three significant French-speaking countries in the African top 20, and two Portuguese-speaking nations. And this is the wild thing to me. About one out of every 10 Africans lives in Nigeria. And for the Adventists, Nigeria is shrinking. Why? Again, this for me is a mystery that I would like to somehow solve. And to give you a longer view, this slide is from the Pew Research Center, Future of World Religions study that appeared in 2015. And they're talking about where they expect religions to be and where religious people to dwell, percentage-wise, in various parts of the world in the year 2050. And they estimate that in 2050, 4 out of 10 of all the world's Christians will live in Africa, which makes Africa the chief battleground for groups like Mormonism, Jehovah's Witnesses, Seventh-day Adventists, because these groups are predatory and parasitic. They feed off the church. Moving ahead, there it is. 4 out of every 10 Christians in the world will live in sub-Saharan Africa. It's been predicted that Uganda will probably, by about this time, have more Christians than all of the Western European countries combined, as memory serves me. And it's just an itty-bitty country with an unnaturally large population, but still, contrast. Let's look at Mormonism for a minute. That's quite a big swooping line for a half century. 1960 to 2010, Mormons grew from 1.7 million in 1960 to about 14 million in 2010. Let's compare these guys with the Jehovah's Witnesses. Aha, look at that. Notice the almost identical starting point there in the left-hand corner of the screen. The Jehovah's Witnesses way outperformed the Mormons in global growth, just astonishingly. And yes, last but not least, let's add the Adventists. Now, they start out behind the other two. And now they are on a path to meet and possibly surpass the Jehovah's Witnesses. Again, the trends, they concern me, as I suspect they concern you. And here's another way of viewing it. Mormons in bars. Not behind bars, just in bars. Well, not that kind of bar either. Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses represented with colored rectangles. And in red, the Seventh-day Adventists here. It's very interesting. The JWs overtake the Mormons, look at this, in about 1970, and never look back. The Adventists overtake the Mormons in about the year 2000, and the Mormons can't seem to match the momentum of either competitor, despite their 65,000 full-time missionaries. Understand that the Seventh-day Adventist Church barely has any full-time missionaries. or interdepartmental employees. They have funny names for almost everything in Adventism, don't they? And they don't have a missionary force like the Mormons. They don't have a sort of every member a missionary situation like we have with the Jehovah's Witnesses, who are about 6-7 million publishers. That's baptized witnesses who go door to door. Some of those, a good number of those, are pioneers who commit to a certain number of hours per month. No, the Seventh-day Adventists are growing really like gangbusters, and you have to say, how? Why? So, let's look at the Adventist top 20 countries and compare that with the Jehovah's Witnesses. The Witnesses beat them in Brazil, but not by much. In the United States, JWs are king. And in a number of other places. But again, I'm having trouble because not all the countries are here. They were when I left home. Look at that. Okay. We want to take a quick look at where the Adventists are winning and losing. The JWs crushed them in the U.S., Mexico, and Democratic Republic of Congo. But the Adventists generally crush all comers in the countries where they're strongest. Let's look at sub-Saharan Africa. Again, missing some countries. You know, I'm going to kind of rip through these because we're just missing data here. I can't be very specific with you. But look at this in Europe. Look at Italy. The Jehovah's Witnesses versus the Adventists. We can see which group has more appeal. Interestingly, the United Kingdom is one of the places where the Mormons are doing especially well, and the Jehovah's Witnesses. Latin America, still missing data. And Mormonism, you can tell, Mormons rule the United States compared with the Adventists. And in fact, Mormonism is a hemisphere religion. Most Mormons are in North and South America and the Caribbean. Very little presence in Africa, Asia, and the rest of the world. They've kind of left those places for the Jehovah's Witnesses and Adventists to fight over. And here we go again. Can't give you names of these countries, or these countries, or these countries, except for a handful. I won't make you suffer. But let's, for as much as I've been able to make clear to you, despite technical difficulties, let's provide a bit more context. Again, Mormons, 65,000 full-time missionaries. Full-time convert-making missionaries. They're not planting crops. They're not, you know, doing marriage counseling. They're going door to door. They're very unusual in this, and they're exceptionally trained, especially in languages, and it's quite an impressive achievement. And the Jehovah's Witnesses, of course, with over 6 million missionaries. And by the way, I mentioned over 500 languages for the Seventh-day Adventists. Go to the Jehovah's Witness website. They have over 1,000 languages on their website. No other organization, to my knowledge, is doing this. Religious, commercial, governmental, they blow everybody else away. But still, the Adventists at half that are pretty amazing. So how are the Adventists approaching this? Well, for one example, the Seventh-day Adventist Church has a plan to reach the world, called the Reach the World Plan. And what are those three winged beings at the top? Shooting down rays to the, I don't know, it looks like a mosque, some kind of squarish secular building, a church with a cross on top. Looks like a hut and some kind of pagoda. They had a strategic plan called Reach the World from 2015 to 2020, and this is 2020. Hasn't been for long, but it is. And understand that this nicely presented plan, which I'll talk about in just a moment, is not the only plan that the Adventist Church is pursuing, because as this little spread suggests, here you have the logos of just 17 of the Adventist Church's ongoing plans, projects, initiatives, what have you. It's ever multiplying. It's kind of like a hydra, really. And again, this is proselytizing, because you will never catch me calling what Adventists do to spread their message evangelism. And I would encourage you to adopt the same posture if your conscience allows it. Now, in addition to these 17, you have, for example, the Great Controversy Project, which started in 2011. And they claim that they put 142 million copies of the Great Controversy into the hands of people, or into the eyeballs of people, electronically and in print around the world. They at least met their goal with this. They now have a feature-length film. How many of you have seen Tell the World? Raise your hands, I'd like to see. Really? Okay, Colleen has seen it. There's Q&A tomorrow, maybe, or during the podcast, you can tell them about it. I couldn't sit through it, but it's beautifully shot. It was done by the Australians. And it's about the origins of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It starts with William Miller, who's having PTSD at the very start, because he, you know, was in battles, and you know, it takes you through his life. Ellen White comes in, and of course, she's gorgeous. It's not nice of you to laugh. But this is a movie that they've been using around the world, and in fact, the producer, who's an Australian, said in words to this effect that that the film very subtly introduces audiences to Adventist ideas like the investigative judgment and the Sabbath. So a lot of Seventh-day Adventist proselytizing is a stealth operation, which many people in this room realize already, but maybe not everyone listening to the sound of my voice, courtesy of the internet. But the thing that I think the church is most excited about right now is something called total member involvement. Mm-hmm. And I talked about that at some length in 2017 when I gave an expanded version of a kind of presentation along these lines. This is something that is heavily promoted. It's multifaceted. You know, the name is suggestive, total member involvement. Each one, reach one, lose none, disciple all, is the motto. And it engages all kinds of aspects of church work, health expos and mega clinics, voice of prophecy Bible studies, those deceptive glow proselytizing tracts, Revelation and Daniel seminars. This is the effort that the church is boasting about when they talk about the 100,000 baptisms in Rwanda in the year 2016. And besides total member involvement, I should mention that the Seventh-day Adventist Church really seems to be quite serious about pushing into so-called unreached people groups in the 1040 window. Maybe they're running out of Protestants to work on. But we'll see what happens. But what is the message behind all of this massive missionary activity? I think you suspect. Now, see, here again, we have total member involvement. And the church is saying this is largely responsible for, at this time, 2017, topping 20 million members. An African scholar, I think this quote is gold, an African scholar in his thesis at the University of South Africa said, Adventist missionaries have never altered what they believe is their distinctive call. Namely, to preach Christ, Sabbath, and judgment to non-Christians, as well as Sabbath and judgment to Christians. Does that not resemble the Great Commission to you? Or is it just me? I'm not sure. That was Jerome Ngabo who said that. but he said it with good reason. So last weekend, Ted N.C. Wilson, General Conference President, was in Southern Africa. He went to Malawi, which is one of the church's biggest success stories in terms of convert growth. And as I mentioned, I think, earlier, Malawi is also a place where the church has the deepest historical missionary roots, along with Zimbabwe and Zambia there in Southern Africa. Wilson was there to meet the nation's leaders. You know, he met with President Mutharika. He met with the mayor of Lilongwe, rallying SDA church members in the National Stadium. And what did he do? He got lost. Oh, wait. Okay, so he was promoting total missionary involvement to the president of Malawi. That's a very interesting thing to me. And the president of the church's Southern Africa Indian Ocean Division, who followed Wilson around on all of his appointments, says, "I can't remember a place where he spoke and didn't mention the three angels' messages. If we don't talk about it, who will?" Good point. And if you read the Adventist missionary literature again and again, you will see references to the three angels' messages. Now, for folks at home who are not familiar with this, for example, here is Bruce Bauer, who is an Adventist professor of missions. "From the very beginning, the Seventh-day Adventist Church has had the goal to preach the three angels' messages to every nation, tribe, language, and people." Okay, that's what it's doing. Well, what are the three angels' messages? Again, for the folks at home. This is derived from a few verses in Revelation 14. And I think it can best be summarized, the thrust of it, the essence of it, as being Sabbath keeping, investigative judgment, remnant church, with some other stuff thrown in. But pretty much that's allegedly what the three angels are talking about. This is the message to the world that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is so busy, 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 busy promoting under a variety of guises. Should we be alarmed? Now, just as a frame of reference, I have breaking news from 1999. Seventh-day Adventist Church membership to triple in size by 2020, according to the Adventist News Network. Yes, they expected that by this year, there would be roughly 37 million Seventh-day Adventists in the world, as opposed to the 21 million in the current statistical support. Now, okay, so they've obviously fallen short, far short of that expectation of 1999. But why? Again, let's look at this graphic. In the 54 years since 1964, 37, rounding, 37.6 million people have been members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Some of you know what's coming. But of these, and we laugh, but of these, 15 million have chosen to leave. The net loss rate is 40%. But wait, there's more. Again, more than 30 million people have been baptized since the 1960s, reported David Trim. Thank you. Nonetheless, the denomination's total membership is less than 18 million. So the question is, where are these 12 million people? Where are they? Who are they? This is serious stuff. Just behave. No? All right. But really, what is the spiritual state of the more than 12 million men, women, and children around the world who have left? Does this alarm and concern you? Concern me that they didn't just sort of evaporate? Conclusion. Brothers and sisters, I think it is fair to say that in light of the data before us, a compassion dictates that we, being the body of Christ around the world, mount a strong, sustained, and strategic response to the SDA missionary challenge. Don't just sit back and wring our hands. Don't just wish it were otherwise. I mean, we need to do something actually on an organized level, a very broad, organized level involving many, many people. And here's the triage aspect of it. We need to be equipping vulnerable believers to recognize and resist the serious errors of Adventism. I know that Life Assurance Ministries is doing this. Can you name three others who are intentionally doing so? Come see me afterwards, because I can't. And especially Christian leaders across sub-Saharan Africa. There's that word again, triage, because this is where the wound is growing at the greatest speed, really, is in East and Southern Africa. And our organization has plans, and we are partnering with Life Assurance, and I ask you to pray for this, while at the same time boldly speaking the truth in love to both Adventists and former Adventists who are still in spiritual captivity. So we kind of have three groups that we could be alarmed about, if you will. And we should give this very serious thought. Remembering always that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and authorities and powers of this dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms, not just flesh and blood Adventists, whose work may alarm us, offend us, provoke us, but they're not the real enemy. Instead, we are to put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, we may be able to stand our ground. Amen? And after we've done everything, to stand. Thank you.
So if you can open up your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. The title of this talk is The New Lawgiver, Jesus, and this is also the title for our conference. I think in no other passage of Scripture, perhaps, than in this section, three chapters, chapter 5, 6, and 7, do we see a deeper outworking of what it means for Jesus to be our new lawgiver. And so I would love to go a little bit into chapter 5 especially and look at some of the threads, and not just the individual passage itself, but how this passage and how Matthew as a gospel itself connects so intricately and deeply with the entire Old Testament, which Jesus is the fulfillment of. So if we look at the synoptic gospels, of course, we know that Matthew, Mark, and Luke are broadly similar in their structure. If we can we can schematicize them in the following way, we have the beginning of a story. In two cases, we have birth narratives. We have kind of a brief interlude, and then until Jesus appears on the scene at the age of ministry. We have a time of ministry, and then we have suddenly Peter's confession and the transfiguration, which is sort of the high point of these gospels. It occurs in all three of these gospels, and then we have about half of these gospels, the rest of the half, devoted to the slow march to Jesus' cross. And so don't let anybody tell you that the gospels are simply biographical accounts of Jesus' life. They are so much more than that. They are essentially extended passion narratives. In fact, we can see that if we look at the geography of these various locations. So if we look, for example, at a map of Israel here, we see that the transfiguration occurred way up north there in Caesarea Philippi, about as far north as Jesus went in his ministry. And that's quite symbolic. The Via Dolorosa, of course, is known as having taken place in Jerusalem, but in a very real sense, the Via Dolorosa began at the Transfiguration after it, way up there in Caesarea Philippi, went all the way down to Jerusalem. So very significant thing for us to grasp in terms of the Gospels as a whole. But now we come to Matthew itself. Some of the themes in Matthew and some of the ways that Matthew is structured as it relates to the Old Testament. And I want us to look, first of all, at this diagram here that shows us the way that Christians typically understand or have understood the Old Testament to be divided. So if you look on the right side there, you see that we have a couple divisions. We have the Pentateuch, the books of Moses, the law. We have history. We have poetry. And then we have the prophets. If you look on the left side, you see that according to the Jewish tradition, we actually only have a threefold division. So we have the Torah, which is the same as the Pentateuch. We have the prophets, which begin with Samuel and go all the way to the minor prophets. And then we have the writings, which are kind of a grab bag of various other sorts of things, which are why they're called the writings. So you see kind of a contrast there. That is very significant because you'll see that Jewish tradition around the time of Jesus had seen either a threefold division, as you see here, which later run out the day, or a twofold division, so that you would have Moses exemplifying the Torah and the prophets, which include the prophets and the writings themselves. So with that in mind, let's look at a couple of passages in the Gospels and in Acts. Look at this. He said to them, this is the parable that Jesus is telling, if they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead. So interesting that he's pointing back to antecedent revelation. In this case, it appears that he's pointing to the entire Old Testament as a prerequisite for believing in Christ. Now, here's another one. This is the road to Emmaus. Beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in the scriptures the things concerning himself. Very interesting. Now, lest you think that this is simply a way of identifying the prophets perhaps as speaking something, here's the early part of John. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we've found him of whom Moses in the law and also all the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now, interestingly, here's another one, by the way. From morning to evening, this is in Acts, he expounded to them, testifying to the kingdom of God and trying to convince them about Jesus, both from the law of Moses and from the prophets. So we see that again. But that threefold division, we also see in at least one passage in the New Testament. It's interesting that Moses is clearly encapsulating the Torah, and the prophets, of course, are called the prophets. But the Psalms are sometimes used to identify the writings. And why is that so? It's because the Psalms begin, they head the entire section of the writings. So the Psalms are the first book in that section. And notice the order as well. Moses, the prophets, and finally the Psalms. Now, if we go to this passage in Luke 24, this is what Jesus is saying. And he said to them, these are my words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. Now, if you didn't have that background information, you might be wondering, okay, I see that there are some messianic Psalms, but why would he mention the Psalms in connection with the law of Moses and the prophets? It seems to me that, and a lot of scholars have been indicating, that this is a clear connection and an indication of the entire Old Testament as pointing to Jesus Christ. Now, keep in mind those three divisions again. We've got the Torah, we've got the prophets, and we've got the writings. The close of these individual sections is also very interesting. So if we turn to Deuteronomy, which is the last book of the prophets, the Torah, chapter 34. It's an interesting text here. And there has not arisen a prophet since in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, none like him for all the signs and the wonders that the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt, to Pharaoh and all his servants, and to all his land, for all the mighty power and all the great deeds of terror that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. Now that chapter also records the death of Moses, and a lot of scholars would say that it's probably unlikely that Moses was writing about his own death. And of course, evangelicals will differ on this question. Perhaps he wrote the account of his death just before he was dying. But it's interesting that this particular passage also raises interesting questions. Because why would Moses be writing about a prophet not arising since his death? I mean, it doesn't make sense. I mean, Joshua comes on the scene, but wouldn't you want to give a little bit of time for it to perhaps develop and see whether a prophet has in fact arisen in Israel like Moses? And that's why a lot of scholars, evangelical scholars, would say that this particular section was appended at the close and the completion of the Old Testament canon to indicate that there in fact has not yet arisen the prophet that Moses said. Because he did say in Deuteronomy earlier, that the Lord himself will raise for you a prophet like me, and you shall listen to him. It's very interesting that this same kind of anticipation occurs in the other two headings of the Hebrew Bible. So, for example, we look at the close of the prophets. That would be the last book is the Malachi, the last minor prophet. It says, remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and rules that I commanded to him at Horeb for all Israel. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction. It is that anticipation. Elijah the prophet is coming. And finally, the close of the writings, which would be 2 Chronicles. Now, Chronicles is, according to the Hebrew Bible, the last book of the Bible. Now, it says this, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and also put it in writing. Now, this is the Cyrus who allowed the Jews to return back from the exile and even commissioned that they would build the temple. In other words, a kind of restoration. He is a restorer. And in fact, when you look at Isaiah chapter 45, you see that he's even named the anointed of the Lord. It's very interesting. So it says, thus says the Lord to his anointed. In the Hebrew there, it's the word Messiah. In fact, Cyrus is a kind of Messiah. And a lot of scholars have seen Christ typified, albeit in a distant sense, in Cyrus, king of Persia. So it's interesting that the whole Hebrew Bible appears to witness in some sense to the coming of this Messiah. But what about Matthew itself? It's interesting here too, because when we look at Matthew, we discover fairly quickly that it's divided into alternating sections. You have narratives followed by lengthy discourses. In fact, Matthew is famous for being the one gospel that is very heavy on discourse, Jesus' teaching. And so there's a long piece of discourse. You have discourse number one, which is our Sermon on the Mount, chapters 5-7. Then you have some more narratives. Then you have mission and martyrdom. This is Jesus sending out his disciples, chapter 10 of Matthew. You have more narrative. Then you have the parables of the kingdom. Then you have more narrative, life in the church, how the church is to be organized, the coming church. Then some more narrative, and finally we get the Olivet Discourse. But just to show you that this is not the figment of some scholar's imagination, there's a very key phrase that occurs at the end of every single one of these discourses. So you look at these in turn. There's some variation of the phrase, and when Jesus had finished these sayings or speaking these things. So discourse number one, and when Jesus had finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching. This is at the very end of the Sermon on the Mount. Discourse number two, when Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples. He went on there to teach and preach in their cities, and so on. It's even more striking when you look at the original Greek. If you look at that one phrase, it's identical in all five discourses as a very clear marker. Now, what do you think Matthew is perhaps trying to show with these five discourses? Well, a lot of scholars have felt that this is a way for Matthew to identify Jesus as the new Moses, the lawgiver, because, of course, the Pentateuch itself is a fivefold book. The law of Moses is a fivefold book. So Matthew is inserting and structuring his entire gospel in several unique ways that allows us to see what's behind his purposes. We even look at Moses and Christ, we can compare them and see some interesting parallels here. So you think of Moses as the Redeemer who is preserved in the Nile River from the wrath of Pharaoh. You see something similar going on in Matthew 1 through 2. You have a prophet who delivers the new Torah. That, of course, would be all of the five Matthean discourses seen as the Torah. You have a miracle worker who redeems his people. These would be the narratives that intersperse the discourses. So he does miracles, tons of miracles, of course, in Matthew. He's a miracle worker like none other. And of course, when we look at the Torah, we see that Moses was performing amazing signs in front of the people through the hand of God. We have Moses as a mediator who meets with God and shows and gives the law to Israel. But Christ, as the transfigured Son of God, is present with God in a very special way. And in the Sermon on the Mount, he is doing something that Moses could never have dreamed of. And we have Moses as a pater familias who explains the terms of the new covenant. So the Jewish boys and girls at the time of the Passover would ask the famous question, "Daddy, why is this night all different from all other nights?" And of course, the father would give the answer, "Because the Lord led us out of bondage in Egypt, the Passover. God saved us." And Moses instructed that each family would say this. And what do we have at the Last Supper? We have Christ preparing to lead his people out of bondage, the bondage of sin and slavery. And he's instructing them. He's giving them a meal. And he's giving them a meal that they are going to memorialize forever. And finally, we have a leader who instructs his people what to do when they enter the promised land. You have the Great Commission given by Jesus. Go into the entire world and preach the gospel, baptizing the nations. So very interesting connections here. And as we lead up to the Sermon on the Mount, there's an interesting fading of John the Baptist and a revealing of Christ. Christ is being brought onto the scene. So in Matthew 3, you have John the Baptist, prominent, baptizing Jesus. He's seen as the greatest of the Old Testament prophets. And then Jesus is tempted in Matthew 4. John is arrested. He kind of fades from the scene. Isaiah is claimed as having fulfilled with Christ going up into Galilee and proclaiming the gospel. And finally in Matthew 5, the lawgiver has arrived. He's here. So let's take a look at that Sermon on the Mount. Go back to Matthew chapter 5. Now, there's been a lot of views on this sermon over the years, of course. It's a highly disputed passage. But I just want to go really fly through a couple of these particular views. We have the Reformed or / Augustinian view, in which simply takes a covenant theology perspective where Jesus is affirming and expounding on the law of Moses. So he's fully affirming it. He's teaching it to his disciples, and he's expanding it. Then there would be the medieval view where Jesus is actually intensifying the demands of the Mosaic law. He's piling on the pressure. He's saying, well, there's a higher law I'm giving you that's in line with the Mosaic covenant, the Mosaic law, but it's simply an expanded version. You would also have the Anabaptist variety where Jesus is simply radically altering the Mosaic law. He's kind of breaking it off, and he's saying, that was a bad thing. We'll go through a new phase that's much better, and the world will be a certain way. And along with that, you would have the liberal view, skip down past Lutheran, where Jesus is kind of providing a vision for an ideal society, how we could imagine utopia, perhaps. An interesting one also is the Lutheran one just above, where Jesus is demonstrating the impossibility of keeping the law, kind of a law-gospel contrast, where Jesus is providing extreme demands from his own law so that it would drive us to trust in him and to rely on him alone for our justification. And finally, we have sort of the older dispensational view in which the Sermon on the Mount is part of the old covenant. It doesn't really apply to the church. It doesn't apply to us. So it is not really that applicable. Now, I'd say we could gather some interesting strands from these views and perhaps incorporate some of them, but I think this time I would like to look at one aspect of the Sermon on the Mount that I think is not received enough attention. That is how Christ, in fact, himself exemplifies the Sermon on the Mount for believers. Now, I do believe that the Sermon on the Mount is applicable to believers, but only by virtue of them being inside of Christ. So we talked about that earlier today, that we are in lawed with Christ. We are in Christ. He is in us. And we are almost like little Christs, if it's appropriate to say that. Only because of what he is and who he is and what he's done for us. Let's look at that a little bit here. And on a brief structure outline for chapter 5, I think we can only go through chapter 5 and look at some things here. We got the Beatitudes, which is the first part. Then we have the brief section on salt and light, where Jesus is saying to his disciples, you are the salt, you are the light of the world. Then a kind of a contested passage where Christ says that he is the fulfillment of the law, and there are differing views on what that law indicates and how Jesus fulfills the law. And finally, we have the six so-called antitheses, where Jesus says, you have heard it said, but I say unto you, he does that six times for six various things. And that's kind of the outline for Matthew chapter 5. Now, the first verse says the following, seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. I think first that indicates to us that this is a sermon for believers. Notice that his disciples are coming to him. So it is applicable to us. We can draw from it. But notice also that he's going up on a mountain. Now, how many of you have been to Israel? Anybody here been to Israel? A couple of people. Anybody been up to Galilee? North, yeah. How are the mountains there compared to Californian mountains? Not very impressive, I'd say. But notice that he says he goes up on a mountain. In fact, if you look at the Greek translation of the Old Testament, there's only one place in the Old Testament where that exact same wording occurs. That is in Exodus 24, verse 18. Moses entered the cloud and went up on a mountain. And Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. So I think Matthew is kind of creating a signal here. He's sending a signal. And we need to have eyes to see and penetrate through his thoughts and understand what he's trying to do here. A little bit of an interesting thing here is the Beatitudes themselves linguistically. Now, apologies for those who are going to glaze over this, but what I've done is I've taken the liberty of transliterating the entire section of the Beatitudes into Latin characters. So, of course, we know the New Testament was written in Greek, but what's going on here is something very interesting, something that my boss, the individual that I work with at Tyndale House has pointed out. You notice that I have underlined a couple of words, and then I've highlighted the initial letter in each of those words. So at the top, you have a section where there's a lot of P words. So the first one is tochi to pneumati, the poor in spirit, or the penthundes paraklithison, those who hunger, they will be comforted and fed. What that is indicating to us, I think to me at least, is that Jesus is composing this in a very skilled way. He's composing it in a masterful way, and it's likely also that he composed it in Greek. So there's a big view out there that Jesus never spoke Greek, he never knew Greek, but this here seems to indicate that he's using the original language here, Greek, which would make an interesting thing. He's up there in the north near the Decapolis, and he's talking to these people who many of them would have been Greek speakers. And he's using wonderful, beautiful language. But more than just the language, what is he saying in those Beatitudes? Well, here's one way I look at the Beatitudes. It's kind of a portal into Christ's law. It's sort of the door that we step into. Isn't it interesting that the Sermon on the Mount, Christ's law, begins with the Beatitudes? It's so interesting. He says, blessed, blessed, blessed are XXX. Now, when we look at Psalms, a lot of scholars had viewed the first two Psalms as doing something similar. So if you can turn to Psalm number 1, it's interesting, Psalm also begins with blessed. And it's talking about the blessed man. And we're all probably familiar with this. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Now, that is certainly applicable to us as believers, but you notice that it's singling out a blessed man. And a lot of commentators have seen this in linkage with the second psalm, which is a very powerfully messianic psalm, which actually describes that blessed man himself. So the Psalm number 2 begins with, why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his Messiah, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast their cords away from us. Of course, the New Testament quotes this in Acts. This was the fulfillment at the trial of Jesus. Herod and Pontius Pilate and all the Jewish leaders were gathered together, conspiring against that one blessed man, Jesus. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord holds them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage, and the ends of the earth your possession. You will break them with a rod of iron and dash them to pieces like a potter's vessel. Now therefore, O kings, be wise. Be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way. For his wrath is quickly kindled. Now listen, blessed are all who take refuge in him. So before we can apply the Beatitudes to our life, we must see them as being fulfilled and exemplified truly and radically in the person of Jesus Christ. If we consider some of these Beatitudes, I think it'll make sense why this is inevitably so. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Can you just imagine Jesus yearning for God and withdrawing and praying all night? I think our prayer lives are often so pitiful because apparently we don't need God that much, right? I mean, that would be the inevitable conclusion. We pray little because we think we don't need God. And yet here is the Son of Man tarrying with God all night, thirsting for righteousness. Blessed are those who mourn. Of course, we know that Isaiah called him a man of sorrows. The shortest verse in the Bible, Jesus wept. There is a quality of the Christian life that we see so acutely pictured in the life of the man, Jesus Christ. Blessed are the meek. The Old Testament says that Moses was the meekest man on earth. Yet when we place him in contrast to Christ, there's no comparison. And Jesus says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Was there anyone who ever lived and thirsted for God's righteousness like the Lord Jesus Christ, who would drive out the tax collectors and money traders out of zeal for God, not out of personal pride or spite? He cared for God's righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Now, this is a no-brainer. Is there anyone who has ever been more merciful than Jesus Christ? I think of my life and the ways that I have failed, both before my conversion and even in my Christian walk. And yet he holds me fast. What kind of a God is this? Amen. Blessed are the pure in heart. They shall see God. Not only did Jesus see God, he was God. No one communed before God like the Lord Jesus Christ within the fellowship of the Trinity. Blessed are the peacemakers. And Jesus came to heal the divide. Ephesians 2 says, "For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create himself in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace. While there was previously conflict between men, hatred, Jews and Gentiles, and there was conflict between God and man, man hating God, God righteously condemning man, the Lord Jesus Christ came and made peace." Blessed are those who are persecuted. Was there anyone who was ever hunted down like Jesus? There's often many psalms in where David laments that they hunt down for me my enemies, they are after me. But that pales in comparison to the one righteous Son of God coming to earth and permitting himself to be hunted down like a wild animal. So we see a flavor here of the Sermon on the Mount. This is something that is radically new, totally different, because of the person of Christ and because of who he is. And if we go on, we look at the way that we parallel Christ in very striking ways. So salt and light, the next passage, the next section of chapter 5 says, "So you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the earth." It's interesting that John in chapter 8, verse 12, he says very clearly, "I am the light of the world." Yet in Matthew 5, Jesus says, "You are the light of the world." How can I be the light when Jesus is the light? Well, it's only if I am in him, if I am part of the body of Christ, if he has gone before me and shown the light, and if I can reflect his light somehow. So this is something that is radically new and different from the old covenant. And of course, we come to that disputed passage, Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 to 20, where Jesus says, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot, or a tittle will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, anyone who relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Now that phrase there, an iota or a jot, is very significant because it's giving a vivid picture of the intricacies, the little details in the law. Forget Ten Commandments, We have a whole body of legislation given to us. Does anybody know how many laws the rabbis counted in the Old Covenant?
613.
Wow, you guys are all rabbis, right? 613. Now, as we learned earlier, and we of course we know this, the law is a unit. All of this, as a unit, according to Christ, must be fulfilled in Him. And there's no one else who can fulfill it. No one else. Not even an iota or a tittle. I explained those two terms to you. Here we have a picture of a beautiful Hebrew manuscript, one thing that kind of makes my heart skip a little bit. You see that Hebrew, for those who don't know, was read from right to left. So it's kind of interesting there in terms of that unique thing. But here are a couple of Hebrew letters on the right for you. At the top, you have that jot, which is the smallest letter in the Hebrew alphabet. It's the jot. It's the yod. So it's quite small in comparison to all the other letters, which are much fuller and extend down all the way. In some cases, they even extend above or below. And then at the bottom there, you see that these two letters are distinguished by this little tiny overline that juts out. That's what the tittle is. And in this case, the way that you tell between a K sound on the left and a B sound on the right is by extending that little tittle. So according to Jesus, everything, it's a vivid way of expressing the fact that everything in the law and the prophets and the writings must be fulfilled in Christ. Now, Matthew has an interesting way of using fulfillment, because when we hear the word fulfill, we can kind of glaze over it or think, yeah, fulfill, I guess it's a prophecy or something like that. But just think of the word fulfill. It really consists of fill full. You're filling something full. So that leads us to imagine perhaps a glass that we need to fill up with water. Until it has been filled up with water, it really is quite useless. It's just lying around there. In fact, it was intended to hold water. It was intended to be fulfilled. Now, if you can think of the Old Covenant a little bit like that, it was intended to be fulfilled. It had to be fulfilled. Everything about it was expectation and anticipation, looking forward. And Matthew uses that word in a very particular way, this sort of a broad way, more than simply pure prophetic fulfillment. So we look at, for example, Matthew 1, verse 22 to 23. This is an example of something that we might see as a more prototypical fulfillment. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Isaiah had prophesied that this woman would conceive and bear a son, and that exact same thing happened. It was fulfilled in the New Testament with Jesus. Now look at this one in Matthew 2. He rose and he took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Out of Egypt I called my son. Does anybody know where that is quoted from in the Old Testament? It's actually from Hosea. Now, if you look at the context of Hosea, it's not as directly apparent to us that Jesus is being prophesied here, because the initial thought is to look back at Israel being called out. And of course, that very phrase in a similar, slightly reworded sense occurs earlier in the Pentateuch where God says, "Let my son go. Israel is my firstborn." But Matthew is using fulfill in a broader sense here. He's using it as a pattern for Christ to fill up and fully exemplify. Or Matthew chapter 3, here's one other example. Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." This is his baptism. He is getting baptized. I mean, imagine the people, tax collectors, Pharisees, standing in a line, walking down to the river, Jordan, to be baptized, beating their hearts, confessing their sins, acknowledging that they are sinners, and then all of a sudden, Jesus comes. I mean, what is he doing there? He doesn't belong there. And yet he's saying here, "Let us fulfill all righteousness." He did it for us. He didn't do it for himself. He did it to fulfill all righteousness. That brings us finally to the six antitheses. And this is also a point of contention in a lot of Christian circles. But let's look at them and think for a moment. Now, if Jesus was not thinking of the Mosaic Law here, because, of course, that's what I'm going to argue for in these six antitheses. But if he was not thinking of the Mosaic Law, why does he preface these sayings by saying, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets"? He says that, we look back in our passage in chapter 5, verse 17. He said, "Do not think." He's almost anticipating the objection from people who are going to say, you're messing with the law of Moses. You can't do that. Don't do that. So it seems to make sense here. And of course, notice Jesus' bold words. In each of these six antitheses, he's saying, "But I say unto you." Now, there was only one person who could say that, to Moses' law. And that's Jesus Christ, the new lawgiver. He talks about murder. "Thou shalt not murder." And he says, "If you hate your brother, that is tantamount to murder." And it's not as if Jesus is now raising the bar and as if the Old Testament had no concept of love or the fact that hatred was wrong. It's just that Jesus is showing our path forward as new covenant believers through his own model, through his himself being the embodiment of all that is fulfilled in the law. And all that is fulfilled indeed in all of the Old Testament. The second one is adultery, of course. I've often, I don't know if you guys do this, but when we share the gospel, there will be a tendency for some of us to jump to the Ten Commandments as a way of, you know, of showing man's need for a savior, because it's pointing out our sin. But then almost all of us, when we get to the commandment for adultery, we'll add in Jesus' words here. Now, if you lust, that's tantamount to adultery. And what we're doing there is we realize that that is not the full extent of what God requires of mankind. Think of all of the concubines that David had, or the polygamous marriages. However, when he lay with Bathsheba, Nathan came immediately and condemned him. What a contrast. Now, does it mean that God didn't care about polygamy back then, or he didn't care about concubines? No, absolutely not. Our God is the same. But Jesus has come finally to give us the full revelation and help us to fully understand. Divorce, only in cases of sexual immorality, says Jesus, are you allowed to do something like that. Swearing oaths, there were detailed list for how to do this and what kind of way to do this in the Old Covenant. But Jesus says, don't swear at all. Just make your yes, yes, and your no, no. An eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. Haven't you heard the statement, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth and the whole world goes blind? Yeah, it's a sort of a way of digging at the Old Covenant law and saying that's horrible, that's cruel. When in fact that person who, I think it was Gandhi who said that, simply misunderstood the intent of the law there, of the Mosaic legislation. This was a theocracy, a civil government ruled by God, and this was the principle called lex talionis, which is simply that there must be equity in administering justice. You're not to favor the poor or the rich. You're to have equal rules, equal playing field. But what are we as new covenant believers to do? Are we to take our cue from the lex talionis? Or are we to look to Jesus Christ, who did not consider robbery to be equal with God, but he emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, and he gave his cheek to those who hit him on the face? Love your enemy and hate your... love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Now, some take this one here as evidence. Aha, that's not from the Old Covenant, because there's no exact phrase, hate your enemy. But of course, we have some of the Psalms which talk about hatred for enemies quite distinctly. And are we to look at that and say that that David had an anger problem? Well, no, he was calling for righteous retribution from God. What does the New Covenant say? We leave God to do the avenging. In this time, in this dispensation as Christians, we're to walk meekly and humbly. We're to suffer wrong for the sake of Christ, because Christ, our Master, went before us. He suffered in our place. And if the Master is going to be treated in this way, how could we expect not to be treated this way as well? So this is our lawgiver. This is our Jesus. And so it's so significant that I think we as believers, as New Covenant believers, listen intently to what he tells us. At the Transfiguration, in Matthew 17, we read the following. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John his brother and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah. Moses, of course, representing the law, and Elijah as the paramount Old Testament prophet. And they were talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good that we are here." He's sputtering here. "If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." But even before he could finish, the word says he was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." Listen to him. So this evening, as I'm talking to you about this Jesus, I don't know where you each are individually, and whether or not you have encountered this Christ, this Messiah, because I guarantee you, it's not the same Jesus that is presented in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But realize that this is the Messiah who we will be judged against. It is not the standard of Moses that we must face on Judgment Day. It is Jesus and his standard. And Jesus Christ himself came according to the scriptures. He was born under the law, born of a virgin. He lived a sinless life. He never sinned, not even once. He never had a bitter thought, an evil thought. He only did what was pleasing to his Father. And then he went to that cross. He bore the sin of his people. All of the guilt and crimes that we have committed were imputed on his account. And there he suffered under the wrath of God, extinguishing our sin, utterly obliterating it. There's no sanctuary for the sin to be taken up to. There's no additional scapegoat to handle our sin. He took it all. And then he rose again 3 days later. He lives forevermore to intercede for you and me. And so the call now is, as Paul says in Acts 17, God now commands all men everywhere to repent of their sins, to turn to Jesus Christ for life, to believe on him, to give up, literally give up on self, to come to the end of yourself, and to place your entire destiny, your entire being, your entire body and self and soul upon Jesus Christ, trusting in him alone for your salvation. And God's promise to you is, if you do that, he'll make you a new person. He'll come to dwell in you. He'll change your heart forevermore. He'll wipe away your sins. You will be God's son, God's daughter. It's all because of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our lawgiver, who went before us, who has given us everything. So I invite you, if you have not done that, to trust in him, trust in God's Son. Heavenly Father, what a joy it is to look at your beloved Son, and you delight in showing him to us, and you delight in what he has done for us. Yet you spared him not. You gave him for us. There's no other possible gift that could be greater, and yet you gave it to us. You loved us, Father, when we wanted nothing to do with you. Those here, perhaps, if there's anyone who does not know you, pray that you would send your Holy Spirit to awaken hearts, to turn hearts to Jesus Christ, for everyone to trust in him alone, to forsake every hope of gaining any righteousness of their own, to despair of any righteousness of their own, and to delight in the righteousness that Jesus Christ provides, a righteousness that the Bible says is an alien righteousness. It does not belong to us. It is fully and completely your Son's. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for what he's done for us. And we ask this in his precious name. Amen.